Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Diksha eLearning. Today, we are going to present to you a webinar on the topic Abnormal Uterine Bleeding, conducted by Dr. Wahida Rahman A. The true beauty of a woman is in the health, in her ability to be active. Dr. Wahida Rahman did her UG from Government Ayurveda College, Tripunithara, and MS in Prasuti Tantra and Stri Roga from Government Ayurveda College, Trivandrum. She started her career as a medical officer in the Indian system of medicine from the year 2006 onwards. She is currently working as a senior medical officer at Government Ayurveda Dispensary, Pathanamthitta. She successfully treated over 1,500 infertility cases. She has conducted seminars all over Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and Karnataka. She has been awarded Best Doctor of Pathanamthitta in the year 2015. Bishak Pratipa State Award of Ayurveda Medical Association of India in the year 2016 and Charak Award of State Government in 2017. It is my great honor to welcome ma'am to this stage. With that, it is my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Wahida Rahman to this webinar. Before starting the session, I would like to go through a few of the basic instructions to be followed throughout the session. For an uninterrupted class session, use a microphone, use a laptop with a high-speed internet connection. Please make sure your microphone is on mute to have a disturbance-free session. In case of any disruption, please check your internet connection first, and if the problem is within our network connection, kindly raise the issue in the chat box. Filling your full name to be displayed is appreciated. Any questions can be sent in the link provided in the chat box. All questions raised in the link will be addressed at the end of the session. Now, I would like to hand over the session to ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Good evening, everybody. A warm welcome to one and all. Today's our topic of discussion is abnormal uterine bleeding. In the name of God Almighty, with the blessings of all my gurus, from first letter to till now, now we can start the session. Management of abnormal uterine bleeding in Ayurvedic perspective. Abnormal uterine bleeding, it is well known that any deviation from the normal frequency, that is a 21 to 35 days, and normal duration, that is 3 to 7 days, or amount of menstruation 30 to 80 ml, it is in the text wise, in women of reproductive age group. Any deviation from this is known as abnormal uterine bleeding. Incidence, 20% of gynec OP cases are complaining of abnormal uterine bleeding. The normal menstrual period, blood loss less than 80 ml, average 30 to 35 ml. It is in the textbook. According to Ayurveda, the blood loss is average 120 ml. It is normal. That is Chatvaro Rajasahasrina. Then duration of flow 2 to 7 days, average of 4 days, and cycle length 21 to 35 days, average of 28 days. This is the normal. Any deviation from it is known as abnormal. Phases of the menstrual cycle. We can analyze there are 3 phases of menstrual cycles. First one is the follicular phase, and the second one is the ovulation, and the third one is the luteal phase. The follicular phase is also known as proliferative phase, begins with the menses and ends with the luteinizing hormone surge, LH surge. Then ovulation, that is 30 to 36 hours, begins with the LH surge and ends with ovulation. Then luteal phase, or it is known as secretory phase, this begins with the end of LH surge and ends with the onset of next menses. This is the cycle, normal cycle. This is the hormonal pathway of normal cycles. That is, initially, the FSH is gradually increasing, and estradiol is increasing in the proliferative phase. Then LH is increasing at the time of ovulation. LH becomes peak. Then LH get down after ovulation, and it is in a straight line. Then progesterone initially is the straight line. It becomes increase after ovulation, and it becomes maximum on the day 21st. Then it will become downwards. This is the normal hormonal pattern of the menstrual cycle. Then cessation of menses. Two main mechanisms is there. Formation of the platelet plug important the functional endometrium. That is, we all know the endometrium has two layers, one stratum basalis and stratum functionalis. Then stratum basalis is common and stratum functionalis shed every menstrual cycle. Then the prostaglandin dependent vasoconstriction. It is important in the basilar layer. First one in the functional endometrium, then in the basilar layer. We all know the uterine, the endometrial arteries are or the endometrial capillaries are in curly hair-like appearance. It lays very much important in the hemostasis during the menstruation. During every Braxton Hicks contraction, it leads to controlled bleeding due to the hairy nature of the capillaries of the endometrium. So there will be controlled bleeding after any after the contraction. In the cessation of bleeding is there in endometrial hyperplasia and other disease of endometrium like thickening of endometrium, etc., or the increase of E3 hormone, the endometrium become thickened and the hairy nature of the capillaries become lost. It will become straight line like a pipe, and then the shedding of endometrium is fast, and then clotted bleeding there may occur. This is the anatomical function, anatomical reference of the endometrium. Then the clinical types of abnormal uterine bleeding. First one is polymenorrhea, that is frequent menstruation, that's less than 21 day menstruation at regular intervals. And second one is menorrhagia, excessive and or prolonged menstruation at regular intervals. Then there is another one is metrorrhagia, uterine bleeding occurring at completely irregular but frequent intervals, the amount being variable. And menometrorrhagia, excessive or prolonged bleeding at irregular intervals. Intermenstrual bleeding, bleeding of variable amount of occurring between regular menstrual periods. That is the intermenstrual bleeding. Then hypomenorrhea, that is the scanty menstruation. Amount of menstruation is very less, scanty. Then oligomenorrhea, infrequent menstruation. That is, the menstruation occurs after 35 days. It is known as oligomenorrhea. There may also the amount is less and may be associated with the oligoovulation. Then amenorrhea, absence of menstruation for more than 6 months is known as amenorrhea. Then postmenopausal bleeding, uterine bleeding that occurs more than 1 year after the last menses in a woman with ovarian failure, that is a postmenopausal bleeding. These are the clinical types of abnormal uterine bleeding. Then coming to the etiology, primary menorrhagia or DUB, then secondary menorrhagia. Primary menorrhagia, there may not have any underlying cause. Puberty menorrhagia, etc., comes under this. Then secondary menorrhagia, there may be systemic causes like hypothyroidism, SLE, liver failure, clotting dysfunction, uterine causes like fibroids, polyps, etc. Iatrogenic, IUCD, intrauterine contraceptive devices and injudicious use of hormones, anticoagulants, etc., causing iatrogenic uterine bleeding. Then emotional causes. Emotional crisis may increase the uterine bleeding and may change the uterine regular pattern. Then pregnancy and related disorders should always be ruled out first. In our college days, there is one case having severe menorrhagia. She is a plus two student, and we give musli, khadiradi, pushyani, etc. Whatever the measures we can give, we give. But there is no stoppage of the bleeding, severe bleeding. So we admitted in our college. Next day we do an ultrasound scan to rule out the cause. There is incomplete abortion is there. That is, after that she admit the case. Otherwise, she denied the we interrogated. She denied all the chance for pregnancy. But after seeing in the ultrasound scan, she admit. Then DNC done and cotyledons, etc., and thrown out. Then only the case become success. Otherwise, we will end in a great failure due with the treatment. That if there is pregnancy and other complication, there may be prolonged bleeding. So in reproductive age group, irrespective of marriage, etc., pregnancy and related disorders should be ruled out first. Then etiology of AUB. There are structural etiology, life cycles and type, and anatomic type. The structural palm coin, non-gravid woman, gravid uterus causing bleeding with pregnancy. Then lifestyle, pre-puberta, menarche, reproductive age, postmenopausal age. Then anatomic, and then bottoms up, that is from the vagina, introitus, vagina, cervix, uterus, fallopian tube and ovaries, etc. There is any causes having the menorrhagia. Then figure classification of abnormal uterine bleeding, that is the palm coin. Structural causes of heavy menstrual bleeding is palm, that is polyp, adenomyosis, leiomyoma, submucosal or other leiomyoma. Then malignancy and hyperplasia, this is the palm. Then the coin, that non-structural cause of heavy menstrual bleeding, that is coagulopathy, ovulatory dysfunction, endometrial or primary disorders of the endometrium, iatrogenic, not yet classified, that is the coin. Here also there is a Tanner classification like P1, A0, L, etc. According to the cause, etiology. Then endometrial polyp. We can see in our OPD, there are patients with endometrial bleeding or menorrhagia having endometrial polyp. There are two types of endometrial polyps. One is benign and other one is malignant. The benign polyp can be easily managed with our medicines like Panchagola Asava, Kumari Asava, Jeeragarishta, etc. with Pulingadam, etc. And it also managed by the principle like that Rektagulme Puranatham Sugasadhita Hedavaha, it will shed off. It will shed off and the patient bring that washed contents like that. But if there is no changes in the bleeding or if there is no changes in the size of the polyp after 3 cycles of medicine, please do DNC and histopathological examination. The second type of polyp, they may be angling to the endometrium and it may cause malignant changes. So if it is not born by 3 months medication, please do DNC and histopathologic examination. The polycystic ovaries. The polycystic ovarian disease or PCOS is one of the main syndrome that causing every type of menstrual irregularities. That it will cause initially hypomenorrhea, then oligomenorrhea, then menorrhagia, then metrorrhagia, and after it will maybe premature ovarian failure and ending with the amenorrhea. So the PCOS is one of the syndrome having all types of menstrual irregularities. This first one is the normal ovary and the second one is the polycystic ovary, that is the ovaries are appears wearing a necklace, white colored pearl necklace pattern. Then adhesion due to endometrium, endometriosis. Endometriosis also a cause for menorrhagia. I will explain in later with our Ayurvedic management. Adenomyosis, here also ectopic endometrial tissue in the myometrium lay down poor endometrial support for a pregnancy, and also the uterus become bulky and size of the uterus become bulky and the myometrial glands are myometrium having glands of endometrium inside it. That is the indwelling of the endometrium into the myometrium. This is another type of endometrious, that is endometrious interna is known as adenomyosis. Wherever the endometrium lays, it have the functions of secretion and desquamation at the time. So when adenomyosis occurs, it will result severe congestive dysmenorrhea. Wherever it secretes and desquamates, it have to come out. So the uterus become more contractions and the congestive dysmenorrhea is more, and heavy bleeding with a severe pain and associated symptoms may occur during adenomyosis.
Ma'am, excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am, you're on mute, ma'am.
Now?
Yes, ma'am. Now it's over.
can I go to previous slide or continue? No,
you can start from this first, from this slide, ma'am. From the beginning.
From this slide.
Yes, this slide.
Okay, uterine fibroids. There are several type of uterine fibroids. That is the pedunculated fibroids, intracavitary fibroids, intramural, submucous, and subserous fibroid. The subserous fibroid or pedunculated fibro, nothing about with menorrhagia. But intracavitary and the submucous fibroids, they are associated with the menorrhagia. So while we assessing the treatment of fibroids, the site is more important than the size. The size of the fibroid have less important, but the site of the fibroid having the more important. If the fibroids in the intracavitary or submucous, there is a more chance for getting menorrhagia and more chance for getting malignancy also. So be careful in the treatment of fibroids, the size. Sorry, the site. Then endometrial cancer. In endometrial cancer also, there is profuse bleeding. That is, there is profuse menorrhagia with the foul smelling and with the severe bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding also there, contact bleeding also there, and severe foul smelling discharges are also there. First, we have to identify the cause and the part of bleeding, etc. Then coagulation disorders. Role of the coagulation disorders like inherited von Willebrand's hemophilia, acquired ITP leukemia, drug-induced Coumadin, heparin, aspirin like drug-induced. So identify, is there any cause like this? Then bleeding from other side, that is from neoplasia or hemorrhoids, gastrointestinal tract, then genitourinary tract, urethral carbuncle or diverticulum, renal lithiasis or hemorrhagic cystitis, then gynecology, labia, cervix or vagina, trauma, infection or neoplasia. Every site may have the bleeding. Then etiology of abnormal uterine bleeding, life cycle approach. First one, prepubertal and menarche, estradiol withdrawal bleeding at birth. It's a 9-month baby. Her mother brought the baby to me that she having menstrual bleeding. That is her surface of the vagina or surface of the intrauterus, there is bleeding. Only 9-month baby. It is not her menstruation. It is due to the estrogen withdrawal of the mother that occurs in the baby's body. Then men are coagulation defects, hypothalamic immaturity, psychogenic menorrhagia may occur at the time of menarche. Then reproductive time, pregnancy, anovulation, anatomic causes may be the reason for the menorrhagia. Then postmenopausal carcinoma, vaginal atrophy, and anatomic causes. Then investigations for young girl with puberty menorrhagia, complete hemogram with the platelet and coagulation screening is necessary. For reproductive age group, pregnancy to be ruled out first, complete blood count, thyroid function test, ultrasound scan, pap smear should be done. For perimenopausal age group, complete hemogram, pap smear and ultrasound scan. Then local examination, bleeding, speculum examination, bimanual vaginal palpation examination. Then fractional curettage for identifying the cause of the menorrhagia. 3 samples, endocervical, lower segment or upper segment should be taken. This is a modern management. Importance of pelvic USS to rule out the uterine or ovarian masses. Endometrial, second one, the endometrial thickness. In transvaginal scan, we can assess the endometrial thickness. And an endometrial thickness of more than 12 mm is in reproductive age group is significant, and more than 5 mm in postmenopausal age group is significant. Here, in the reproductive age group, up to 14 mm, we can 14 mm, we not need any management. Just rest is needed, and just the diet restrictions like vidahi virudha etc. should be avoided. But in the and in the perimenopausal up to 6 mm it is normal. After that we have to treat, otherwise it will cause amenorrhagia. It is significant more than 16 mm and more than say 6 or 7 mm it will cause amenorrhagia. Then the treatment in according to modern explanation and reassurance, treatment of anemia, if there is any anemia then treat it first, then medical treatment, non hormonal or hormonal they will take. The I give this as introduction to understand our Ayurvedic perspective and Ayurvedic management of menorrhagia. First, initially we have to understand the condition, so I give this introduction topic. And then treatment of anemia is very much important in the treatment of puberty menorrhagia also. During puberty menorrhagia, most of the children having less hemoglobin, that is less than 10 hemoglobin there, it will cause menorrhagia. Why it is causing menorrhagia? That is the less amount of hemoglobin will give less amount of thromboplastin for the hemostasis, so it will cause menorrhagia, and the menorrhagia will cause anemia, and it becomes a vicious cycle, that is menorrhagia and anemia. So first treat that anemia with the vyoshadi takra, vyoshaja moja tamirama karimbirimba etc. are said in the sahasra yoga, the keraliya chikitsa krama. Vyoshadi takra and annabhedi sindura etc. are very much importance in the giving you puberty menorrhagia condition like anemia. Then this is the Marina system. Marina system nowadays it is used for control bleeding in adenomyosis etc. Some people it will get okay, and some people it will get infected and can be thrown out. Then surgical management, minimal invasive surgery, endometrial ablation, that is trans cervical ablation of endometrium, laser ablation, thermal balloon ablation, microwave endometrial ablation, radio frequency ablation and cryo ablation. These are modern techniques. Hysterectomy should be the last resort. Here we can see there are a lot of hospitals done hysterectomy because if there is not controlled with medication, they will directly go to hysterectomy. But hysterectomy should be the last resort, is the treatment principle. Abnormal uterine bleeding according to Ayurveda. Coming to our Ayurvedic perspective, it may be classified as Rekta Yoni, one among the Yoni Rogas, Rekta Yoni. Then Asrubdharam, Asana Upadrava of Yoni Roga. Increase in Rekta Pramana, especially Rasa Bhava, and hence the name Asrubdhara. Assessment, long duration of flow, pallor, presence of anemia, then passing of blood clots, increased number of sanitary parts, we can assess Asrubdharam. Then causes, we explained earlier, organic causes like a fibroid uterus, adenomyosis, IUCD, PID, etc. And systemic like liver dysfunction and severe hypertension. In liver dysfunction also, and in liver, early stages of liver cancer also, there is menorrhagia. Because the liver is the site of Rekta Dhadu, isn't it? The liver and the spleen is the site of Rekta Dhadu. Arthava is Akneya. It is very much in Asraya Bhava of our Rekta Dhadu. So the liver disorder produces menorrhagia, and also the in the formation of ovulation also the sex hormone binding globulin from the liver is essential for the correct formation of ovulation. It also get from the normal liver. If agrodis vitiated or liver dysfunction is there, then it will cause an ovulation or decreased ovulation etc. Then causes continuous endocrine cross like hyperthyroidism, emotional upset, hormone therapy, and etc. It also causes menorrhagia. Then, according to Ayurveda, the nidana of Asrubdhara is Lavana, Rekta Pitta Vardhana, Amla, it is also Rekta Pitta Vardhana, then Kadu, it is Vada Pitta Vardhana, Lavala Amla, Kadu, Adisevana, Guru, Vidahi, Snigdha, Virudhashana, Athyashana, Ajirna, Shukta, Dedhi, Mastu, Sura, Malsya, Rekta Pittakara, Amlapaga Dravyas, and Ushnavirya Dravyas, all of its Adisevana will lead to Rekta Pramana Vaigradi, and also it will lead to Rekta Vaigradi, and it will lead to the menorrhagia or the Asrubdhara. So Levana amla kadu extra adisevana is the main reason for the rakta vigrudi of asrgara. Then samprapti here dosha vada abana and vyana vada can be affected. That is abana vada from its natural sites and the function it is affected. That is shukla artava garbha nishkramanadi kriya. Here artha nishkramanadi kriya may be vitiated. So it is nishkramanadi in every day or everywhere. So it is abana vigrudi. And then vyana vigrudi. Vyana vayu is directly related with our circulation. So the circulatory problem is also there. So abana and vyana vigrudi is there. Then pitta pajaka and ranjaka pitta vigrudi is there. Then kapha kledaka kapha vigrudi is there. Dushya rasa rakta is the dushya. Then agni jadarakni and dhatukni mandya is there or dhana vigrudi is there. Then srodasas rasa rakta mamsa medo and artha srodas are vitiated in this condition. Srodo dushti adipravarti and vimagagamana are seen in this condition of asrgara, and in apravarti sanga is seen in the condition of spotted bleeding or scanty menstruation or oligomenstruation etc. There is sanga is there. These are the avranajanya. Then sadhya sadhyada arthopatti koshtagadi asenobajidam raktam dhamanibhyam rdopunaha. So any initiation from this can be sugasadhya, easily manageable. Then endometriosis is the shakha gadi of the doshas. Here this krichra sadhya, initial endometriosis it is sugasadhya, and in extensive endometriosis it is krichra sadhya. There are two types of endometriosis. That is the presence of functional endometrium other than the original site is known as endometriosis. There are two types. One is endometriosis interna and the other one is endometriosis externa. The endometriosis interna is otherwise known as adenomyosis. We explained earlier adenomyosis. And endometriosis externa is known as the endometriosis like in presence of tubes, ovaries and pelvis, and later in the blood cells also this endometriosis externa. So shakhagadi is very well explained. Then PCOS aveva dushti, it is yapya, because it is a lifestyle disorder. It is not a not a disease. It is a group of symptoms. It is not a gynecological disorder. It is a metabolic disorder occurring due to the lifestyle imbalances. So the treatment is also the lifestyle modification and strict diet with good exercise. So it is yapya. Whenever the lifestyle become hampered, then the disease become reappearing. Then submucous fibroids and adenomyosis having bad prognosis. I explained earlier that is the submucous fibroids having very chance to getting malignancy, and it also having very chance to become menorrhagic type, because the submucosa that just beneath the endometrium it is in it is vitiated. So there is more chance for getting shedding out, and there is more chance for getting menorrhagia. So submucous fibroids having more chance for malignancy and menorrhagia, and adenomyosis also having how bad prognosis. There is no good prognosis. If we get the patient initially, we can manage with our bela kudituvadi kashaya said in sudiga jwara chandraprabha guliga and kumari sarasa or kanya sara. We can manage the adenomyosis in the early stage. If there is extensive adenomyosis and the myoma are of full with the endometrial glands, then the prognosis is very bad. Then cervicitis, polyp, PAD, etc. having good prognosis. First we have to identify the cause, then treat accordingly. It is good, having good prognosis. Then management in Ayurveda. Nidana parivarjana and assurance, that is levana amla kadu vidahi virudha athyashana etc. can be avoided. And assurance, give assurance to the patient that's what is your cause, this is the cause for your menorrhagia, and this is the treatment, and this is the pathyavadhya you have to follow. We give the assurance. Then rektadisara chikitsa, durnama chikitsa or rekta arsha chikitsa and rekta pitta chikitsa യോനിവ്യാപ ചികിത്സ എക്സെട്ര ക്യാൻ ബി യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ ദിസ് കോണ്ടെസ്റ്റ് അക്കോർഡിംഗ് ടു ദ അവസ്ഥ. ചികിത്സയ പ്രധാനം അവസ്ഥാന വിധാനം അക്കോർഡിംഗ് ടു അവസ്ഥ വി ക്യാൻ ഇൻകോർപറേറ്റ് ഓൾ ദിസ് ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് ലൈക്ക് രക്താതിസാര ദുർനാമ ആൻഡ് രക്തപിത്ത ചികിത്സ യോനിവ്യാപ ചികിത്സ എക്സെട്ര. ദെൻ അനുലോമന ഫോർ അനുലോമന വി ക്യാൻ ഗിവ് ഗന്ധർവഹസ്ഥാദി കഷായ ഗന്ധർവഹസ്ഥ ചിരുവില്ല ഹുദാശ വിശ്വ കഷായ ദെൻ ചിരുവില്ലാദി കഷായ ദെൻ വൈശ്വാനര ചൂർണ എക്സെട്ര വി ക്യാൻ ഗിവ് ഫോർ അനുലോമന ദർ ഇസ് സംഗ ഇൻ സം ടൈപ്പ് കണ്ടീഷൻ ലൈറ്റ് ഇസ് സ്പോട്ടഡ് ബ്ലീഡിംഗ് ഫോർ മോർ ദാൻ ടെൻ ഡേയ്സ് ഓർ സിക്സ്റ്റീൻ ഡേയ്സ് എക്സെട്ര. സോ വി ജസ്റ്റ് ഗീവ് അനുലോമന ഫോർ ഗെറ്റിംഗ് ബ്ലീഡിംഗ് ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റ് വിൽ സ്റ്റോപ്പ് ദ ബ്ലീഡിംഗ് പാസസ്. സോ ഇഫ് ദർ ഇസ് ജസ്റ്റ് അനുലോമന ഇസ് നീഡഡ് വി ഹാവ് ടു ഗിവ് this type of medicine and also the chiruvilluvadi kashaya having aashugari effect in that region also and it is also good for abana anulomana and vaishyanara churna is also good in anulomana and also it will correct our jadarakni and also the dhatvakni. then garbhashaya shodhana for garbhashaya shodhana pulingulambu saubhagyashundi dronapushpi sarasavit pamjagari സപ്തസാരം കഷായം പലാശത്വക്വാദ എക്സെട്ര നീഡഡ്. ദീസ് ആർ യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ ദ മാനേജ്മെന്റ് ഓഫ് പി സി യൂസ്. ദർ മേ നോട്ട് ബി മെൻസ്ട്രേഷൻ ഇൻ ദ നോർമൽ ടൈം ആൻഡ് ഓൾസോ ഇഫ് ദർ ഇസ് മെൻസ്ട്രേഷൻ ഓൺലി സ്കാൻഡി മെൻസ്ട്രേഷൻ ഓർ സ്ട്രീറ്റ് ഓഫ് മെൻസ്ട്രേഷൻ. സോ വി ഹാവ് ടു ഷോ ഡു ദ ഗർഭാശയ ശോധന ആൻഡ് ഓൾസോ ഇഫ് ദർ ഇസ് എനി block inside the uterine cavity then we have to do the shodhana. For shodhana we can use this type of medicine, that is a pulingalambu saubhagyashundi drona pushpi sarasavit pamjagari and saptasaram and palashatopadam etc. then kledaharam and sangrahanam, because if there is more kleda or more pichlata of the srava then we have to use the kledahara drugs. This padola kadrohaniyadi kashaya, it also a hepatic protective padola kadrohaniyadi, so any hepatic chances also it will cure. then traindiyadi kashaya, puluchiyadi kashaya, tiktagam kashaya, mahatiktagam, gulgulu tikta etc. these also are the kledahara drugs we can use in the asrudhara treatment. then stambhanam, initially we never do stambhana because if there is ama presence let it go, we try it to go. If there is no accumulation of ama is needed, no malasanjaya is needed, so it can be go. If there is shuddha rakta is coming out or if there is the jeevana rakta raktam jeevanam idi sthiti is coming out, we have to stop the bleeding by any means according to our acharya, that is rakta stambhana ubhaya. ഫോർ ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് രക്തസ്തംഭനോപായ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് സന്താനം സ്കന്ദനം ചൈവ പാചനം ദഹനം തഥാ വ്രണം കഷായ സന്ധത്തെ രക്തം സ്കന്ദേ ദേഹിമം തഥാ സംഭാജയിൽ ഭക്സ്മ ദാഹ സങ്കോചേ സിര. അവർ ദിസ് ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് പ്രിൻസിപ്പിൾ ടേക്കൺ ബൈ ദ മോഡേൺ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് എ ക്രയോബുലേഷൻ തെർമൽ അബുലേഷൻ എക്സെട്ര ദർ ടേക്കൺ ഫോർ ദ മാനേജ്മെന്റ് ഓഫ് മെനോറേജിയ ബട്ട് ദ സന്താന സ്കന്ദന ആർ ലിവിംഗ് ഫോർ അസ്. സ്തംഭന വി ക്യാൻ യൂസ് മുസ്ലി ഖതിരാദി കഷായ ദ്രാക്ഷാദി കഷായ ശതാവരിയാദി കഷായ പുഷ്യാനക ചൂർണം വിത്ത് ഹണി ദെൻ ശതാവരി ഗുളം സരസിത മകരന്താദി ചൂർണം അശോകത്വക് മിൽക്ക് ഡികോക്ഷൻ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ക്ഷീരപാക ദെൻ by any of this means if there is not stopping of the menorrhagia then we have to think about other kriyakramas in our science, that is it is very well explained that nasya karmana rudur vyabadyade or nasya karmana rudur vyabadyade or yoni rubashishyadi. Here during the amidartha phase we need the vyabad, that is here the phase is amidartha, more loss of blood, so we have to arrest the blood, so we have to do nasya in this condition. Otherwise in normal condition during menstruation please don't do nasya, because the nasya karmana rudur vyabadyade yoni rubashishyadi. But here the condition needs the stoppage of menstruation, so nasya karma we can use as an emergency management in our principle in the menorrhagia. So the vashasurasa nasya or the Durvasvarasa Nasya or Kshirabala Nasya etc. are give good results in the stoppage of menstruation. So 3 days Nasya is needed. It is of Marsha Nasya, that is 8 drops in each nostril, 3 days early morning. This is needed for the stoppage of menstruation. If other medical managements are failed, then we have to use Nasya for the stoppage of menstruation as an emergency management. Then Piju, etc. Piju, the rectum stambayare himam, rectum skandayare himam. So the Piju dharana with the Dhanandarandaila mixed with the Kadalifala or Dhanandarandaila mixed with the Navaneda, etc. can be applied over the Brahma region and over the Adonabhi region. The skandana of blood occurs due to the rectum skandere himam. So we can manage the bleeding with these applications. Then gulika preparations, Pushyanu gulika, Pravala Panjamrita rasam, Chandrakala rasam, Pradarandaka rasam, Chandraprabha gulika and Dhatri loham etc. we can use according to the condition. Arishtasavas are less used in the management of menorrhagia, but in hypomenorrhea, oligomenorrhea, etc., we can use. And these arishtasavas used are Kudajarishtam, Draksharishtam, Ushirasavam, Chandanasavam, Ashogarishtam, and Sharibadhyasavam. These arishtasavas have some effect in the management of normalizing the menstruation. Then management according to the different doshavastas. Paithika asrigdharam, heavy, prolonged and profuse bleeding is there. Nidanda rectam sravadi muhur muhur adharthi man. So, rectayoni asrig adhisrude, paithiki bhuri arthava is there. Protocol for the emergency management, whatever the medicines the patient taken now up to this time, please stop all the medicine. Wait without interference, stop all the medicine. If there is amanubandha, then use shadanga. Then if there is not amanubandha, then use another medicines, other medications like mahadikta kashaya, shadavariyadi kashaya, sarasida magarandadi churna, ashokato kshirapaga, pravala bhasma in milk, mocharasa in milk, payasya, ulpala, visa, chandana, musta, with paya, sharkara or madhu, we can use this type of drugs. All these drugs are pitta shamana and pitta vigara prashamana. So we can use this type of medicine. Then madhoga, tribhala, lodha with madhu, mahatikta kridapana, shadavidyadi krida, dhatriyadi krida, kriyakramas like virejana. Virejana will stop the excessive menstruation. Then snehavasti, if needed, we can use with madhu ishtiyadi taila. Then piju in adonabhi, nasya and murthaila, like that of dhanandarandaila with the kadalibhala or dhanandarandaila with the navanida, etc. Then if it is kabaja asrugdara, then scandi and prolonged bleeding is there. Avrana janya as in PCOs, like clotted in grandi arthava. Here the treatment principle providing rucha or snigdha ushnaguna, fasten the shedding of the endometrium. Nimba and Guluji with Madhya or Arishta. Nimba Mridasava, Kumariasava, Punarnavasava, etc. can be used here. Then Vadiga Asrudharam. Here, that is the black colored and Bahu Vedana here. Tilachurna, Dedi, Krida, Vasa with Madhu, etc. can be used. Mahamarshadi Thailam with the Jiragarishtam, it is very much effective. And Navayas Thailam with the Dashamularishtam is also effective in the management of Vadiga Asrugdara. Then the Asrugdara due to the hepatic failure or liver failure. There is one case, that is there is profuse bleeding and it will not get with any our Musliga Diradi Pushyanik like treatment. And it also they done treatment in the modern side, that is tranexaminic acid, mefenamic acid, etc. they given, but there is no cessation of menstruation. First, initially while using the medicine it will become less, and just after the medicine it become profuse bleeding. Like that, there is no stoppage of medicine with any of the management, modern and Ayurvedic, etc. One patient come here. By analyzing her history, it is evident that she's having hepatomegaly with the liver failure. All the liver function parameters are vitiated. Then stopped all the medicine and then advised and avoid fatty, salty and fried items like that. Then with the bhumya malagi, that is the kwadam, and also advise the vasa gluchyadi kashaya with the arogya vardhani vadi and vrishakritam with the rajanyadi churnam. Vrishakritam, risho asra pitte, vrishakritam also very much effective in the management of liver functions also. So vrishakritam with the rajanyadi churnam and vasa gluchyadi with the arogya vardhani vadi, rektastambanobayas like and piju, nasya, etc. used. Within 5 days, the menorrhagia become controlled, and after the usage of 3 months medication, after this, then the scanning done, there is no problem and there is normal bleeding. Nowadays also there is normal bleeding, there is no problem, but she is under my control for her diet. Otherwise, if the diet pattern is getting hampered, it will also cause the hepatic malfunction and also lead to menorrhagia. Then carcinoma of cervix. I never treated this carcinoma cervix, but understand so many cases and referred them for the better management. Here we can understand with the postcoital or contact bleeding, false smelling bloodstain discharge, postmenopausal bleeding, irregular bleeding, etc. Then we have to screen where it is malignant or not. If there is any chance for malignancy, then refer the patient for the better management. Nowadays there are more better management like leap surgery, etc. Refer the patient for the better management. Risk factors for carcinoma of cervix is early age of intercourse, repeated or frequent childbirth, multiple sexual partners, HPV infections type 16 and 18 are more chance for getting malignant. Then low socioeconomic status, having less immunity, and then smoking. Cancer is a less immunocompromised stage. So wherever the immunity become less, and wherever these risk factors are there, there may be chance for getting malignant or getting cancers. One of our patient doctor, she said that she's having endometrial hyperplasia and coming to our Ayurvedic management. She's a modern doctor working in RCC. And then she told me like that, fortunately or unfortunately, our doctors are doing so much hysterectomies. So nowadays, there is less chance for getting uterine malignancy. Especially the cervical malignancies are cut off due to the and a large amount of hysterectomies like that. Then treatment consideration, Rasagandhi Mezhuga, Tripala Guggulu, Mahadikta Krida, Gulgulu Tikta Krida, Madhusnuhi, etc. The patient, we screened for cancer, we refer the patient for modern management. After the modern management, they come back to us for the prophylaxis management. That time, I give these medicines for the prophylaxis only, not for the treatment of cancer cervix, for the prophylaxis management. Then, pathya, this is the normal pathya said in our yoni rogas, that is, eva annam abhayarishtam seedhum tailam cha sheelayet vipalya yoraja pathyani prayogamscha samachigan, that is, diet made with barley, abhayarishta, seedhu, tailam, powdered pipeli, pathya, lohabasma with honey, etc. We can set as the pathya ahara vihara for the man, normalcy of menstruation. Then there are some home remedies for the management of menorrhagia also. That is the lejjalu, that is the bryophila sensitivum, the samula lejjalu, 3 lejjalu and 1/2 teaspoon jeeraga, and a paste well, and add 1/2 glass milk boiled with a 4 glass water, reduced to 1 glass, and take once per day for 5 days. It will reduce a type of mild to moderate menorrhagia. It will reduce. So for the emergency management, we can use Leggjalu milk decoction and Negroda milk decoction, and then the red variety Abamarga milk decoction or Abamarga paste with the kanji is also given for the management of menorrhagia. These are the some home remedies we can use for the management of menorrhagia. Then coming to the conclusion, though multiple factors are involved as the cause for acidura, the lifestyle, food habits, family history, occupational, and above all the psychosocial and marital related to are found to be the major contributors. Contribution of Ayurveda is valuable in this junction. Ayurveda can contribute in each and every that is a lifestyle problem, food habits, we have good pathyabathya, and in the if there is any family history of malignancy or any family history of menstrual disorders, we can screen the patient earlier and we can advise them not to get become that type of diseases. Occupation and above all the psychosocial guidance we can give, we can give very much that the assurance and the psychosocial that the dhairyatmadi vikyanam we can give also is a good treatment for menorrhagia. Then contribution of Ayurveda is valuable in this junction. Coming to the end, my sincere gratitude and thank to all for the patient hearing, and my sincere gratitude to Dr. Sudhir sir. He called me for taking a class in the Diksha platform, and all the participants, and Dr. Sri Lakshmi, etc. My heartfelt gratitude. Okay, and now it is for the time for discussion. Please. And Dr. Sri Lakshmi, you can arrange the questions and you can ask the questions, and we can explain. Okay,
thank you ma'am, thank you so much ma'am. Before moving to the discussion session, there is a special announcement. Diksha e-learning is organizing a lecture series on Matra Sanskriti conducted by Dr. Wahida Rahmani. It starts on September 2nd. So for further updates, please stay connected in all our social medias. Now the session is open for discussion. I request the participants to ask their question through the link provided in the chat box. Ma'am, we have a few questions ready. Can I start, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. First question: patient aged 26, unmarried, with irregular menstruation, a known case of PCOS. Is now yes. complaining of bleeding after serious exercise or strenuous work. What may be the cause, ma'am?
The patient is PCOS, non case of PCOS, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. For the PCOS, I told that the PCOS have the all menstrual irregularities, especially the most advanced irregularity of PCOS is menorrhagia. That is, during PCOS, there is no ovulation. There is only the E3 level in increase in the blood. That is the estrogen. There is no ovulation. There is endometrial hyperplasia there. Because of the anovulatory phase, the E3 is increasing, endometrium is adding to it. So the endometrial hyperplasia is there. So with the endometrial hyperplasia, if she do any strenuous work or exercise, etc., it will come out. That is, it is like the recta gulma inside the uterus. So recta gulma, if it get any chance to break it, so it will come out. And also the endometrial hyperplasia is one of the cause for the deteriorating the normal hairy or the normal hairy appearance of the curly hairy appearance of the capillaries. Here hyperplasia is there, so there is the capillaries become straight line like, so there may be shedding occurs when she did the exercise. Do you need its management?
They asked the cause, ma'am, but if you can explain the management also, it will be great.
You do need the management, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So, in this type of condition, we have to give some medication for the shedding of the endometrium and correcting of the PCOS. So we can use the Ashwagandha and Lothrathok. Then Ashoga and Lothrathok for milk decoction or a slight milk and more amount of water is the is needed, and we can give intermittently. Then we can use the Saptasarang Kashaya with Shanga Pushpi Arka etc. for the normalcy of the hormone level E3. Shanga Pushpi is the Methi Rasayana having the action on the hypothalamus. It causes the correction of hypothalamus pituitary ovarian axis and cause the estrogen level corrected, and it also important in the ovulation also. So by restoring the ovulation and by giving endometrium is cleaning, it will be corrected. First we have to shed out the endometrium, then we have to manage with the other diet restrictions and other medicines for PCOS. okay,
thank you ma'am. Moving to the next question, what causes severe pain in the pubic bone during menses? Cycles are irregular, occurring in the gap of 40 to 70 days with scanty bleeding. There is no urinary infection or cramps.
There is no urinary infection, but there may be some pelvic infection. The pubic pubic region pain is at the time of menstruation is the cramping pain for the expulsion of the menstruation. There may be some sort of graha inside the uterus or in the yoni bhaga, and also there may be some pubic infections, some pelvic infection may be there. So we can give in the other time management of adenomyosis also, there may be severe pubic pain and there may be burning sensation in the pubic region also. So then just abhyanga with dhanudrandaila and dhara with dashamoola sridakshira is very much effective for the management of pain and for the burning sensation etc. For the management of pain, it is very much good. That is dashamoola sridakshiram sadyashoola nivaranam. It is a dhara over the pubic region, and then we can do it as piju. And after the menstruation, please examine the patient well, and if there is any chance for a pelvic infection, treat like that. Or if there is no infection, then treatment given to the correction of his correction of her menstruation in the proper time, that is within the 28 to 35 day cycle, 28 to 33 day cycles we have to create. So giving chiruvilluadi kashaya, dhanvantaram guliga, saptasarang kashaya, sugumara eranda etc., these all will get anilomana. The severe pain is there is due to the abana vaigrati, abana vigunada there. So abana anilomana also we can done with the treatment.
Thank you ma'am. Hope the doubt was cleared. Next question. Nowadays menstrual cups are advised for heavy flow, but during removing the cup we have to pull it. Can it induce negative pressure on external OS leading to uterine prolapse? What will you suggest ma'am?
Maybe if it is not properly managed, it may cause that type of problems there. So proper management is needed, proper correct use is needed, and also it is something like inserting into the vagina. Yes. Sudden removal of that also may cause retrograde menstruation, like vacuum cupping etc., so it may cause endometriosis in future.
Okay ma'am, thank you ma'am. Next question. Patient aged 25 years, known case of PCOD, unmarried, scanty bleeding, foul smelling, brownish bleeding sometimes, but prolongs for 10 to 20 days. What can be done ma'am?
It is also I explained in the earlier. It is due to the PCOS. First, we have to anuloma this condition, giving nature vilwadi kwada, saptasaryam kwada with shangabushpi, etc. Shangabushpi arka or sorasa, we can use. Shangabushpi kalka or sorasa, we can use. Arka also use. So, not sorasa, arka or kalka we can use. Then we have to use the ayaskriti and lothrasava. It is helpful for the normal menstruation, and the cessation of normal menstruation is needed. If there is prolonged days, that is spotting menstruation, the vaginal pH become damaged and there may be chance for getting infection also. So in our classics there is said like that bindu pramanena masam api artedi. There is no problem. So here also in the PCOS, the spotting bleeding, the prolonged spotting bleeding, but the HB level is maybe 13 or 12 like that. So there is no the jivarakta shruti. So we have to induce normal blood flow or normal anulomana. We have to induce with our anulomana drugs like chiruvilwadi kashaya. Etc. And in Grandhi Arthava, we can use Saptasarya Kashaya. PCOS is another type of Grandhi Arthava. We can use Saptasarya Kashaya here. And Saptasarya Kashaya is very much effective in this type of condition. We used it to give here the Saptasarya Kashaya Vasti, Dashamuliga Vasti, etc. for the management of PCOS.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question. Lady aged of 77 years old. Complaints of pain in the urethral region during maturation. USG reveals an atrophic uterus with an ovarian dermoid cyst of 3.5 cm in the POD. CA is 125, is within limits. All other hematological tests within normal limits. Please suggest the next course of action, ma'am.
Yes, there is dermoid cyst. Dermoid cyst never goes with medication. Just watch for the dermoid. If it is not increasing with a 3 or 4 months gap, it's no problem. But here we have to give some medication for the that type of pain in the urethral region, etc. It is due to the atrophic uterus. It is due to the deficiency of estrogen. So it is by the age scale or age sabhava, there is deficiency. We can manage this case with the shadavaryadi kashaya and shadavaryadi Krida. If her blood parameters, everything is okay, then we can give with the shadavaryadi krida. Then shadavaryadi kashaya is very much effective. Shadavari chinaruhadi kashaya is also effective for the management with the dhanyandara dailam abhyanga and avagaha in vadakna patra. And also the dhanyandara gel application around the urethral region and vaginal region is also very much good for the management of local action. Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Moving to the next question. What is estrogen withdrawal shedding or bleeding in the perimenopausal age of women? What is the cause and what can be the line of treatment?
In the perimenopausal age, there is an cessation of the ovarian function. So at that time, from the puberty till the time of menopause, there is regular estrogen and progesterone and regular hormonal support for the lady. This estrogen is not only for the menstruation, it is also for essential for the metabolism of bones also. So there is a sudden change in the metabolism also occurring at the time of perimenopause. Age group. So withdrawal of estrogen will cause irregular bleeding. Sometimes there may be endometrial hyperplasia, or sometimes there may be bleeding within 3 to 4 months apart, and large bleeding is there. So during this time, we have to give assurance to the lady that is, it is due to your hormonal changes from your hormonal changes occurring in your body. So we have to manage this with the non-hormonal hormone modulators like that. There is hormone replacement therapy in modern and HRT is they are used, but we have to give non-hormonal hormone modulators according to Ayurveda. there is two drugs which is very much important in the female life, that is a Shatapushpa and Shatavari. The Shatapushpa, it is very much important in the reproductive age group, and the Shatavari also, Shatavari, it is in the lactation, but Shatavari have more role in the perimenopausal and postmenopausal age group. During the sudden stoppage of estrogen, if we give Shatavari, the natural supplement of estrogen like substance, and it also having an important in the metabolism of Astidadu, etc., and it will reduce the osteoporosis and like that of problem. So with treatment with the Shatavari adi kashaya, Shatavari chinnaruha adi kashaya, and vela jeeraga adi kashaya, etc., are very much effective at that time. And then with the Menosan tablet from Himalaya, it is also good for the treatment of hot flushes, etc. The dhanandaram dhanandaram thaila, and if there is excessive hormonal problem, then dhanandaram kuda nasya is very much important in the management of these type of hormonal issues.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Next question: women complains of droplet vaginal bleeding since 3 months. Her age is 65 years old, and menarche at 18 years. So I think it's menarche. Oh, menarche at 18 years, and how can it be diagnosed and treated?
Here, menopause attain in which age?
That is not mentioned.
Not mentioned here. Also, late menarche, and if they are the 65 years, there may be menopause. After postmenopausal bleeding or this type of bleeding, a screening should be done. If it is it is normal or any problem is there, if there is any contact bleeding, first ultrasound scan should be done, then bimanual palpation should be done. If there is any bleed on touch, then please take a pap smear for identifying any malignancy. Then only we can treat this condition. Here, first line of treatment is to identify the cause for that type of bleeding at this age. If there is any infection, if there is any cyst or like that, we can manage. Or if there is the malignancy, then we have to refer the case for the better management.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Next question: how can we diagnose ovulatory and unovulatory cycle?
Ovulatory cycle, it shows a regular pattern. That is, ovulatory cycle from initially there is a proliferative phase of 14 days, then LH surge, ovulation, and secretory phase or progesterone phase of 14 days. But then there's the cycle between 28 to 35 plus or minus 7, 28 plus or minus 7. That is 21 or 22 to 33, 34. It may be ovulatory. Then if there is any doubt for ovulation, then do follicular study. It will very, 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 very clearly says the ovulation. If there is more, the ovulation occurs more than 35 days, there may be oligo ovulation. If the menstruation occurs more than 40 or 45, it may be an ovulatory. Then please check their FSH LH value and also the prolactin level. If the serum prolactin level is increasing, then there may be an ovulation. So according to our acharya, that is vandhyanam kshiranathyastu vadena pariburida tasmat adhigam bhavet. Therefore, there may be an ovulation there. So, kshiranathyastu vadena paripurida tasmat kshiram cha adhigam bhavet. An ovulation then leading to infertility. So, please check serum prolactin level, etc. There are so many tests for ovulation, like basal body temperature test, Mitchell's marks, etc. But it is not confirmatory. We can use this type of drugs test, and the vaginal discharge, and initially the proliferative phase, it is watery, and then after ovulation, it will be thread like. So these are some people, it is not recognize that there is available of an ovulation kit. We can use it with the vaginal swab. or the vaginal discharge ovulation kit can use, but the proper way for understanding the ovulation is follicular study. It gives a correct development of the follicles, or if there is any luteinized unruptured follicle, or if there is any oligo ovulation, etc., we can very well appreciate with the follicular study.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Moving to the next question. Ma'am, if uterine size is less than 3 centimeters, then can we indicate surgery or Shamana treatment?
Less than 3 centimeter, why we go for surgery? For what purpose we go for surgery? This hypoplastic uterus, that is a size is less than 3 centimeter. Not is myoma, this uterine size is less than 3 centimeter, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So it is hypoplastic uterus. Either it may be due to iatrogenic causes like injudicious administration of hormones, or due to the general health debility of that patient. Otherwise, it is due to the premature ovarian failure, etc. First, we have to identify the cause. And the last one, it may be due to Meyer-Rokitansky cluster fuses syndrome, like the chromosomal anomaly, etc. Initially, we have to identify what is the problem. Then we can give medicines like the Vridhi Samane Sarvesham. For the proper nourishment of the uterus, we can add goat uterus with the Shadahua and Pippali, and Shadahua, Pippali, then Palasha Top, etc. We have to prepare like Vasa and use as Mam's Rasa for the patient for 5 consecutive days in a month, for repeat for the 3 cycles. And these 5 days, there is no other medicine needed, only this soup is needed. Tila and Shatapushpa, Palasha, and Pipeli, etc., can be added with the goat uterus and make into vasa. Then, or kashaya, it is said in the Kerala Chigilsa Grandha, that is the Anubhuta Chigilsa Grandha. And I used to give my hypoplastic uterine patients for more than 10 patients. All of them get good results, and 5 of them got conceived and having normal baby, and all of them got menstruation, etc. But if there is any chromosomal abnormality, then this will not get good result if there is any chromosomal abnormality like that. Otherwise, we can manage it with. Then the Shatapushpa is one of the major drug for using in the premature ovarian failure. If there is if we get in the patient in the early stage, we can use we can treat them with the Shatapushpa. That is in the Shatapushpa Shadavari Kalpam of Kashir Samhita, it is clearly said that Rajo Nivirti Nanjaputrada. Here, the Rajo Nivirti may be due to the iatrogenic or injudicious administration of hormone or PCOS like that. If we get the patient earlier, that is if there is ovary, then we can give the Shatapushpa with a Sugumara Krida or with a Tilataila, etc., and then it will produce normal menstruation and normal the uterine cells become normal. But if there is chromosomal irregularity like that condition, we can do anything. And I think the surgery is not having good for this type of condition. Surgery having only if the Meyer-Rokitansky cluster fuses syndrome with the aplastic vagina, etc., then they can do surgery for the vaginal reconstructive surgery. Otherwise, for the uterine cysts, how they can do surgery or what can do with surgery?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Next question. A female 8 weeks pregnancy with torch rubella positive has a history of miscarriage at 2 months due to torch. How to prevent and treat? How to prevent miscarriage?
Initially, and firstly, my humble request it for every doctors, etc., if there is any history of miscarriage, please do thorough checkup before getting pregnant. And if there is torch positive, please do the treatment for that initially. After it become normal, then only try to become pregnant. Otherwise, we can't assure the pregnancy. In this condition, it is 8-week pregnancy and having previous history. Just we can try with medicines like Lakshmana Kshirabhaga. Lakshmana Kshirabhaga. Just we can try. If there is the infection is more in amount, it cannot be safe with this. Okay, but we can treat the case before getting pregnant, and our Madhur Samskriti will assure that type of treatment. That is because we have very much good treatment for torch infections and any other antibody infection inside our body. That is according to our Ama Sanjaya, Mala Sanjaya, etc. Then we have initially we have to treat that infection. Then and from the srodas and etc. We have to get take it to the koshta and Vamana, Virejana or Vasti, etc. needed for the treatment. So before getting pregnant, we have to do some shamana therapy, then shodhana therapy, then with the preconceptional care and with the Lakshmana Kshirabhaga in the before getting pregnant to the 5th month of pregnancy or the 6th month of pregnancy, Lakshmana Kshirabhaga, we can save the next pregnancy. But after getting pregnant, we can use only the Lakshmana Kshirabhaga and the Bala service with Rajaniyadi Churna. It may give some good prognosis. If there is no much infection, it will save the pregnancy. But can't assure this after the conception, we can't assure before conception we have to do the treatment. Just then now just do the the Lakshmana Kshirabhaga or Vadasringashtaka Kshirabhaga or and with the Rajaniyadi Churna Bala service, just do and pray well.
Thank you, ma'am. Moving to the next question. Is using of marine-like intrauterine devices safe, and for what duration? Does menorrhagia reoccur after removing these devices?
It is said that some people having good prognosis with the Marina Institute and some people with having not good that much prognosis, because it is like that of the copper T insertion. Some people have no problem. The other people have problem with the copper T insertion, and there may be perforation or menorrhagia, etc. And there may be iatrogenic allergic reactions, like etc. So the Marina is not completely safe, but in some people there may not any problem, and it may control the bleeding, and by controlling bleeding for more than 6 months or something like that, the uterine have the nature of control bleeding, there may not be any menorrhagia. But if there is adenomyosis, it is reappearing, then it have no use. If there is any perforation or any allergic reaction, it also have no use, and we have to take it out. Okay. Just like that of copper T insertion.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Does any of the Rathastambaka Avaleha for the treatment of AUB can be used, and how many days should be given?
Rathastambaka Avaleha, like Dracha Avaleha, etc., we can, Dhatri Lavha, etc., we can use. And the duration of this type of treatment is initially we have to give medicine for the cessation of bleeding. If there is not Ama Sanjaya, if there is Ama, then we have to let the bleeding or anulomana. If there is not Ama, then we have to stop the bleeding. So initially we have them, we give the measure for stop the bleeding for 10 to 15 days or within normal. If it is stopped, then we have to identify the underlying cause for this type of bleeding. What is the underlying cause and treat that cause. And also we have to monitor this bleeding for three consecutive cycles with medicine, there is no problem. Then three consecutive cycles without medicine also we have to watch for telling that there is no problem with that type of bleeding disorders.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question. Ma'am, how could we detect the presence of Ama in menstrual blood?
It is clearly said in our classics that is the presence of ama. If the menstrual blood sinks well, or and also if there is pure blood, there is no ധൗതം എച്ച വിരജ്യതി, ദർ ഇസ് നോ സ്റ്റെയിനിങ് ആഫ്റ്റർ വാഷിംഗ്. ധൗതം എച്ച വിരജ്യതി, ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ക്ലിയർ ബ്ലഡ്. ഇഫ് ദർ ഇസ് ആമ സഞ്ചയ, ദെൻ ദ മെൻസ്ട്രൽ ബ്ലഡ് ദർ ഇസ് ദർ മേ ബി സ്റ്റെയിൻ ദർ. ആൻഡ് ഓൾസോ ഇഫ് ദർ ഇസ് ആമ സഞ്ചയ, ദ ശശാസ്ത് പ്രതിഭം എത്തു, ലാക്ഷരസോമ എക്സെട്ര, ദ കളർ ഓൾസോ ഡീവിയേറ്റഡ്, ഹാവിംഗ് മോർ പീഡ, മോർ ഫൗൾ സ്മെല്ലിംഗ്, ആൻഡ് ഹാവിംഗ് sometimes itchy nature, and also some people associate with a fever at the time of menstruation, etc., denotes the ama in the menstrual blood.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, can pratimarsha nasya be used during menstruation? Will it cause any yoni shosha?
No. പ്രതിമർഷ ആജന്മ മരണം സിദ്ധം പ്രതിമർഷസ്തു വസ്തിവത്. ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഓൺലി ടു ഡ്രോപ്സ്, നോട്ട് കോസിംഗ് എനി യോനി ശോഷണ. ബട്ട് മർഷനസ്യ ഓർ ദ ഇൻജുഡീഷ്യസ് അഡ്മിനിസ്ട്രേഷൻ ഓഫ് നേസൽ സ്പ്രേസ് can cause yoni shoshana. Nowadays there are so many college students coming with amenorrhea, that is they are by history taking they are using some of the nasal sprays for preventing the allergy, like the cortisol like type of steroid nasal sprays, that may cause yoni shoshana. But the normal pratimarshanasya may not have any difficulty, that is ajanma maranam siddham pratimarsham vastivat, matra vasti and pratimarsha, it may be ajanma marana siddham, no problem, but the matra should not be increased.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, can you please explain in detail about the endometrial polyp treatment?
About the endometrial polyp, the patient coming as with menorrhagia or with a painful menstruation with heavy bleeding, initially we have to give medicine for the decrease of the menstruation with a Lejalu milk decoction or with Ashwagandha milk decoction, etc. We can stop the menstruation, and then we have to assess what is the reason. So then we have to give the Misraga Sneha capsule or the Misraga Sneha for 3 days for laxation. After the menstruation, on the third, fourth or fifth day, we have give the Misraga Sneha. That is, if there is light polyp or light polyp, etc., it will go with the use of Misraga Sneha itself. Then we can do an ultrasound scan on the seventh day, on the seventh or eighth day of menstruation. If it reveals any polyp inside the endometrium, initially we check what type of the polyp is there, what is the size is there. Then initially we think it is benign. Okay, it is benign. Then Rekta Gulma Puranatha Subhasadha Hedavaha. So the Rekta Gulma Hara treatment, like Panchagola Asava, Kumari Asava, and Jiragarishta, Pitha Pulling Goldamba, etc., can be given just 5 days prior to the next menstruation. And Misraga Sneha capsule every day before the menstruation. So that after diagnosing this type of polyp, we can give Misraga Sneha capsule once per day at the time of bed. And then Panchagola Asava, Kumari Asava, and Jiragarishta with Pulling Goldam from 5 or 7 days prior to the next menstruation, and during the menstruation also. And tell the patient, please check for any clot or large clot is coming out. Just wash it and bring it. We can advise them, and then we can advise them to take Panchagola rice gruel at the time of menstruation also. Then after 2 to 3 menstruation, please do another scan. If it is gone, it is no problem. With this type of management, if it does not go after 3 months of medication, and if the size is increasing, then we have to think it like that. If it is, it may get malignant. So then advice for DNC and histopathologic examination for the prevention. And DNC done just after the DNC also, we can do if it is we can do the ക്ഷാരതൈല ഓർ നാരായണ തൈല Uttaravasti for preventing the adhesions of the endometrium and for preventing the recurrence of the polyp, we have to do Charadaila or Narayanadaila Uttaravasti, etc. This is the management of polyp.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to inform the participants that due to shortage of time, we are asking only a few selected questions. Next question, ma'am. Why mostly Ushna Dravyas are mentioned for treating Yoni Vyapak?
Mostly Ushna Dravyas are mentioned. Ushna Dravyas not mentioned. It is in Paithika Vigara, Shita Dravyas are there. Ushna Dravyas are mentioned for treating the Sangha or Arthava Sangha, etc. If there is any obstruction, then Ushna Virya Dravyas having the capacity for clearing the passage or Srodha Shodhana, we can use. Just for Arthava Pravritti, there is Ushna Dravyas are explained. But if there is Paithika Vigara and Paithika, like that is this everything is mentioned, like Guluchyadi, Shadavidyadi, and Drakshadi, etc. Like Shidavidya drugs are used for in the condition. According to the condition, the drugs we can select. Okay. Ushnavirya is for the pravarti of Arthava, Dedi Malsya Kulatha, etc. Because Arthava is Akneya, so Ushnavirya drugs are used for the Nashta Arthava or Apravartamana. Apravartamanam. To pravartamanam, we need Ushnavirya Dravya. Okay,
ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, what is the method of treatment of an unmarried PCOS patient who used to get her periods once in 4 or 6 months?
Once in 4 or 6 months, it is dangerous initially. So please advise your patient with the management, with the essential precautions taking for the management of PCOS. PCOS is a metabolic syndrome. It should be treated with the utmost care. That is, if the patient's cooperation is not good with some of the medication, it is not curable. So the patient cooperation is needed. That is, I advise my patient that is for the for PCOS only 1% for medicine. 99% lifestyle modification with a strict diet and good exercise is mandatory. So your diet should be containing with all minerals and vitamins, etc. we need, and should avoid all junk food, fatty, salty and fried items. With all food that cause metabolic disorder can be avoided. And also, especially the broiler chicken, fast food, etc. can be avoided. And please assure the proper amount of vitamin B and proper amount of the vitamin D, etc. Vitamin D also very much important for the ovulation. So if there is a sufficient amount of vitamin D, etc., if there is not, it should be needed. So the method for vitamin D increasing, like sunlight, vyayama, etc., and yoga, etc., is needed. And good exercise. Good exercise also one of the main treatment for the PCOS. Then only the medicine comes. Strict diet, good exercise, the assurance of proper vitamins, etc. is needed. And for proper rest is also needed. Stress is one of the main factors for PCOS. So proper rest with the please avoid day sleeping and avoid night awakening. Ratri Jagrana is Dusha. It also causes the photoelectric effect on ovulation, causes anovulation leading to PCOS. So Nisha Jagrana is avoided, day sleeping, diva sapna is avoided, circadian rhythm should be intact with early to bed and early from the bed, and morning exercise, etc. It is beneficial. Then only give the medicine for controlling the menstruation or for the production of the apravartamanam. Then dosha rubare vadagavada marganam apravartamanam pitalaihi ubajare tat pravartamanam. Then pitala dravyas can be used for the pravarti of menstruation. For the occurring of withdrawal bleeding, we can use the tamarind juice for 3 days with a half 30 gram tamarind and a half glass hot water. Squeeze well and use in the early morning for 3 days. And with the 3 days, maybe withdrawal bleeding occurring. Or drona pushpiswa rasa with palm jaggery can use. Or some kalka like betel leaf, ginger, turmeric, and the leshuna etc. Or leshuna and kalpa etc. We can use for the withdrawal bleeding. Then we have to do medicine for the normal menstruation with the saptasara kashaya, or if there is any need of chiruvilvadi kashaya, we can do chiruvilvadi kashaya. If there is more granthi or more swelling in the ovaries, we can do with the nimbadi kashaya. Nimbadi kashaya is a Malayala yoga that is said in sahasra yoga, and we can use the nimbadi kashaya. We can use then saptasara kashaya, siruvilvadi kashaya, varanadi kashaya, according to the condition of the patient, according to dosha avastha. We can do so many type of medicines. Any medicine we can use with the strict diet and good exercise only, the treatment should be become and fruitful. So please advise the patient and please give dhidhayatmadi vijnana to the patient, because the PCOS patient may be severely stressed. So we can advise them properly and for the need of proper time of menstruation or the for the need of treating the PCOS to prevent the late time sequelae like infertility, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, adenocarcinoma of uterus, etc. The long time sequelae of PCOS we can prevent with the proper management. Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Next question: how does kledaka kapha is responsible for menstrual irregularity?
Yes. While preparing the slide, I think like that. Anyone can ask this question. Yes, here the kledaka kapha. Where is the kledaka kapha? Where is the function of kledaka kapha? The kledaka kapha's function in the metabolism of the things we can eat, that the aharasa, the kledaka kapha is for the proper metabolism. If there is the metabolism, there is not abha klededi, then the proper metabolism is not take place, and it also give the ama bhuda of the rasa dhadu and rakta dhadu. That it also the artava is the ubadhadu of rakta dhadu and rasa and dhadu. So it may get vitiated. So the kledaka kapha is also take part in the vitiation, and also the presence of kapha in the uterus and the yoni pradesha is also something like that of kledaka kapha. These are vitiated in this type of conditions. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Due to shortage of time, we have to stop here with the discussion sessions. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for all your efforts in answering all these questions so patiently.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity to interact with you.
Thank you, ma'am. Can we conclude, ma'am?
Yes. Where is Sudhir, sir?
I don't know, ma'am. Okay. Thank you,
okay.
Ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you.
With prayers, Sreyo Bhodat Sagala Jananam.
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your knowledge with us. It was a great pleasure listening to you. Quoting Albert Einstein, teaching is the supreme art of the teacher to awaken joy in the creative expression and knowledge. Thank you, ma'am, for awakening us. Thank you all the participants for joining us today. Looking forward to see you all in our upcoming sessions. Stay connected with us in all our social medias for all the latest updates. Thank you, ma'am, once again. Thank you all. Wishing you all have a great evening ahead. Thank you and good night.
Good night.